The idea of grace is that we are showing someone love that doesn't necessarily deserve it. We're just giving blessing when it hasn't been earned. And over the last 3 weeks, we've been talking about grace and struggling to figure out how to apply it in our lives. And I'm trusting that God has given you lots of opportunities to exercise grace in the past week. True? You do a series on this, God's going to say, boy, I really want them to grow in this area, so I'm going to give them lots of challenging opportunities to learn how to show grace in difficult situations. And that's probably been happening with some of you. But that's good. We want to strip away all the stuff that robs us of joy and of peace. We want to be the confident, free person God created us to be, not being controlled by our circumstances, not being controlled by how others relate to us, but that we can be free and confident, and we can receive from people what needs to be spoken into our lives, but we're free to give to others without needing anything in return. So in the last 3 weeks, we've talked about a couple of different stories from the Bible. The first week was Isaac, who would keep digging wells, and then people would come saying, you can't have this water, this is our water, and move on from it. So he would move on from there and dig another well, and they'd come along saying, that's our water too, and they'd have to move on from there, dig another well. And what it was really saying was that what grace is, it's grace isn't something that weak people do. Grace is something that strong people offer. People who are strong because they trust that God will provide for them. Isaac was able to say, well, I can let this well go. I'm stronger than these guys. I could defeat these guys in a battle. I'm just going to let it go. God will provide for me where he wants me. And so he'd move on, and each time Isaac was able to show grace because he trusted that God would meet his every need abundantly. And he was only able to show grace because of that deep conviction in his life. Well, then the next story, we're talking about Joseph and his brothers who had betrayed him, wanted to kill him, but instead sold him as a slave for some money, and Joseph gets sent off to Egypt, totally cut off from his family, everything he knows, and he's a slave there. And yet through that, God encounters Joseph and raises Joseph up in power and prominence. And now he's the second command of all of Egypt, and his brothers are now coming during a time of famine, and they're needing food. And Joseph could think, time for perfect revenge. But Joseph instead shows grace to his brothers that wanted to kill him, to his brothers that sold him into slavery. Joseph instead shows them grace. Why? Because he simply trusts that God is the judge. Joseph said to his brothers, am I in the place of God? In other words, am I your judge? And he could have been, because he's in charge, he's in control. But Joseph understood that it wasn't his job to judge. That he was able to judge the evil that his brothers did to him, that he was able to hand that judgment over to God, saying, God will take care of that. And what that did was it acted back on Joseph to free him to able to show grace and love to his brothers instead of revenge or vengeance or even justice. Then we came into the story of David and Mephibosheth last week, where Mephibosheth was a cripple. He was, in a sense, could have been perceived as King David's ultimate threat to the throne. But King David, instead of killing him, like might have been the culture of that day to dispose of your royal threats, David treats Mephibosheth as a prince. Mephibosheth is moved into a place of royalty. David doesn't treat him as a dead dog like Mephibosheth. I did well last week, didn't I? I got through it all last week. Mephibosheth felt like he was nothing worse. He was worse than a dead dog, but David treats him as royalty. And what we're understanding is that you are all created in the image of God. You may not feel like you're the image of God. You may not feel like you're a 10 out of 10, but God created you to be that. And David understood that he was supposed to treat Mephibosheth in that way. And so what grace is grace understands that even though you may not act like you are royalty, even though you may not know that you're royalty, I'm still to treat you as royalty. Doesn't mean we avoid tension, doesn't mean we avoid discussions, but what it means is I always treat you with respect in whatever circumstance we encounter ourselves. I never devalue you as a person.
I never lower your worth. I always am there to raise you up to be what God's called you to be. And that's how we're supposed to treat everyone we encounter, whether in our office, in our homes, in our church, in our highway drivings, whatever it is. We treat people as the image of God that they are and help them understand that. That's what it means to be showing grace. But I guess the question is, to what extent should you go to show grace? If someone that you loved was in serious trouble, to what extent would you go to save them? For instance, if someone's in a burning house, do you rush into that burning house risking your life to save a loved one? To what extent would you be willing to go to save a loved one? Anyone that you cared about. How far would you go to save someone that didn't care about you? How far would you go to rescue someone that was your enemy? Would you be willing to show grace to someone, or would you be willing to rescue someone if it cost you your acceptance? If people no longer accepted you because of your desire to reach out and rescue and save someone, to show love to someone. If it cost you your acceptance, would you be willing to give up acceptance from others in order to show love to someone? Would you be willing to risk respect to show love to somebody? If you showing love to someone and coming alongside someone meant that you would lose the respect of others or the acceptance of others, would you still do it? Think of a kid in school that sees another kid being bullied, and you know that if I go and I befriend that person that's being bullied, I will lose respect and I will lose acceptance and I will also become the bullied if I show value to that person that's being bullied. Would a youth be willing to do that? Would we be willing to do that as adults in whatever context we find that if I side with someone and I encourage someone and I lose respect and acceptance to show love to someone in this area, am I willing to do that? I guess the question for us is to think through, am I willing to lose acceptance and respect by bringing the good news of the gospel into someone's life? Or does my need for acceptance and respect mean that I'll stay quiet and won't talk about God? I'll stay quiet and not share with them the good news about forgiveness that Jesus wants to offer them. Does my grace have limits? Am I willing to only show grace and love to others when it doesn't cost me at the deeper levels of my identity? That's what we want to think about as we go through this morning. Are there people you're holding back from loving because you're fearful that what it might cost you to love them? Well, think that through. I'll invite the worship team to come on back up and listen.
I want to show you a video clip of an individual giving his perspective. This individual is an atheist, and he's going to talk about his perspective of Christians going around sharing their faith. Christians going around pushing what they believe on other people. And I want you to pay attention because maybe his perspective is a little different than what you would have thought it would be. Take a look. An interesting take on, do you really believe what you say you believe? If you really believe what you say you believe, how could you then just stay silent about it? Well, I want to just do two quick little interviews here. And I'm first going to just invite George to come on up. And I just want to chat with George about his life. We could be here for a while.
all 45 years of it. Enough time.
George, what I want you to be able to share with people is a little bit of passion, because we do the network course, and we just finished doing the network course, and we'll do the network course again in the fall.
But part of the idea of the network course is that we want people to discover what their life passion is. What is it that excites you and energizes you and captivates you, that if you could just focus your life around this, what would it be? And George, what would you say is your life passion?
Which frame of time? Which frame of my life?
Right now.
As I came to know how lost I was, and not even knew I was lost, that's the worst part. And then when I realized I'm found again, well, how could I sit back and not go and tell the other people who I thought I was found with them? Like, and now I know they're lost. Or so in the small words, I see everybody in a spiritual, eternal eyes. So that's what I care about, everybody. Like, it's where they are or where they could be or where they're heading or where they could head.
So your passion then is for people to really see the big picture of how God's at work, heaven, hell, the issues.
Of course. Heaven and hell and how we can have peace and how we are lost without God, without Jesus.
Yeah.
And I've been on both spaces. And now I am now. I wouldn't want to go back to where I was. But hey, like, you just stole it out of my mind when you talked about a burning house. Like, how could you walk by a burning house and not at least dial 911? At least. And if you were a firefighter, now, what would you do? That's your job. So
you have this passion for people to know God, to hear about God, embrace a relationship with God. How does that passion then affect you practically in how you go about your day?
When I go about my day, I just look at people the same way I told you, in spiritual eyes, and I'll do anything to start a conversation. And it doesn't have to be spiritual at first, but then it will have to switch to spiritual. It has to. I have no control over it, basically.
Sort of like Jesus at the well when he's talking to the woman. They start off talking about water, and somehow Jesus turns that into a spiritual conversation. As a result, the whole town gets saved.
Exactly. You just find a way to just connect. I mean, it could be anything.
Wow.
Anything.
So when you started this, like, you start getting this burning passion for people to know about God or to at least hear about God so they make an informed decision about God. So you think, gee, I got to get engaged in a conversation with them. When you first started this, was that a little scary for you?
It was scary, and I made many mistakes. Some people don't talk to me.
What sort of fears were you encountering?
Well, they're going to reject me. But first of all, it started with rejection. Because I'm just going to give a little tiny glimpse of, okay, when I decided that I am found now, and I want to declare it, and I got baptized, I was so excited. So I invited who I thought loved me, or I said, come on, guys, you gotta see this, you gotta celebrate with me. And then some of them said, yeah, we wanna see this. Something went crazy with this guy. But nobody showed up. I mean, if you were at my baptism, nobody showed up. So all of a sudden, the same people, I wanna try to tell them, like, come on, you missed the big thing. There was like conflict all the time. And I just couldn't understand it. So there was a lot of fear, and so I felt rejected a little bit.
Mm-hmm. What would have helped you in those early days? You've got this passion to share with people. You've got this passion to connect with people. But you're feeling a little bit on your own. What would have helped you?
If there was a group of people, or at least a place where I could come and share what I'm going through and compare notes, and like maybe there's anybody could have given me a little tip and I could just went with it, or maybe we could have fed on each other. If there's a group of people that share the same view as me, and they really want to do the same thing, just go and learn or practice how to share your faith, how to answer for the hope you have.
So what sort of recommendation might you have then for LifeBridge now to help people that might be in that similar sort of situation?
If what I just said stirred anything in your heart, let's get together and see what where we're at as a group and just talk about it and see what the issues are, like how we can reach others strategically, not just
nonchalantly, just strategically.
Hmm. So basically a group of people who have a similar passion, a similar desire to be sharing their faith, whether with families or people they know, or maybe even total strangers or wherever.
Anybody.
Wherever they're at.
Anybody.
But if people have a passion, sort of pulling those passionate people together just to build up and encourage each other, to equip each other, that sort of thing.
For sure, yes.
Okay. We're thinking that's a cool idea. Because we know there's some of you here that have the gift of evangelism, but even if you don't have the gift of evangelism, you have a passionate concern for people in your family, people you care about, people that you would like to somehow figure out, how do I just reach into their lives? And we just think it'd be kind of cool if we had a community of people that said, let's get together, let's talk, let's maybe strategize how we can go and do this more effectively, how we can share Jesus more effectively. Maybe it's doing things in the community where it just opens up a doorway for conversation. Maybe we could just plan a series of different things that we could do. Realizing that people are at different levels of comfort, different levels of gifting, different levels of fear. But maybe if we just start someplace with a community, we think that would be kind of cool to do. So if you think that's of at all interest to you, of being a part of a team like that, George is one of those people maybe to come and chat to, because we just want to find out who the people are and then connect them together. Okay. Well, thank you, George.
Thanks.
Appreciate you sharing that. I'm going to have Angie come on up. Angie, can you just share a little bit with us sort of one of these little projects that has been on your heart and why and what you'd like to see happen?
One thing that has come to mind and I suggested to a few people was going out and taking sandwiches to people in need that are on the streets. This idea came around because after being in Honduras and seeing the need that was there, although it's very different from here, when I got home and realized there's things that we could still be doing here that would help our communities. So that was just an idea that we were trying to get some people together to go out and make some sandwiches and take some out to the people on the streets and perhaps offer some prayer and chat with them. We are putting together, as soon as I brought it up, several people have come to me and said that they want to be a part of that. So if you are interested in joining us, please let me know. I will schedule a date. We're currently working through joining up with, there's two different churches that have similar things going on, so we may be joining with them. So if you are interested, please let me know.
And can you describe for them a little bit what that might practically look like on a day? Like, so on the Saturday, first of all, you'd be getting together to...
First, we'd get together to make the sandwiches and whatever kind of sandwiches we decide to make. And then perhaps breaking into small groups and discussing what our goal is going to be. But taking groups of people to the streets and breaking down into smaller groups and maybe walking certain areas with the sandwiches and stopping into different areas. We've currently found three locations that would be in need. And so that's where our focus will be. But I'm still putting together to find out how many sandwiches would need to be made and what we need to do.
What's interesting about this type of ministry is you might have a passion to see this type of ministry happen, but you're saying, but I'm not the person to hit the streets. But you might be the gifted sandwich artist. And you think, gee, I'm not sure I'm quite yet ready to hit the streets, but I'd love to be part of the team that comes and makes sandwiches. I can do that. I've got that spiritual gift. And so, you know, even if you're thinking, I don't think I want to hit the streets, but I'd like to be part of the team and support the team that's going to do that, you could still come and talk with Angie about that and just let her know your interest. And hey, some of you might just be the people saying, hey, I could donate the bread, or I could donate the meats, or the peanut butter and jam, whatever it is. Whatever the case is, you could play a role if you have that sort of passion area. Now, what we're hoping will happen then is after some of these people go and do this, hit the streets, is that afterwards we pull back together and just have a debrief about it. And then out of that saying, are there any other of you here that would like to see something ongoing as a team that would help strategize and plan some of these types of things? That we maybe even strategize planning more training for ourselves and equipping for ourselves and stuff like that. And that's, again, coming back to what George was talking about. So if we have all these people coming together at something like this, I think that'd be a great starting point to talk about how can we just take Christ into our community. So just something to have on your radar. We were originally planning on doing that next Saturday night, but just because we're trying to arrange some things possibly through other churches, I think that date's probably getting pushed to a later date. But we will let you know as soon as we have that nailed down. Thank you, Angie. Appreciate that. Why don't we pray? Father, you left your home. You sent your son from the comfort of heaven and seated on his throne into our community, into our world. You did that because you were passionately crazy about us knowing you. You are willing to risk your comfort and your life to bring us a message of forgiveness that you've made available to us through Jesus Christ. And so, Father, we first of all just want to say thank you. Thank you that you call us to yourself, that you want to restore us to you. But Lord, thank you also that then you place that mission into our hands to continue what you started. And Lord, I just pray that you would inspire us and motivate us to strategize intentionally how we will take you to the streets, how we'll take you into our workplaces, how we'll take you into our families to make a difference in the lives of others. I pray that you would give us the freedom and the desire to do that, and that we would see your church grow as a result. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to tell you a story that sort of brings this sort of sacrificial grace to life, where we give not just of, we don't just give forgiveness, we just don't give mercy, but we strategize and we think through, how can I give my life for yours? Am I really willing to give my life for yours to help you grow in a relationship with God? Are you that important to me? Are the people in my neighborhood that important to me? Are the people in my workplace that important to me, that I will strategize my life and focus around how I can give my life so they can have life? So the Apostle Paul and some cohorts of his, one of them by the name of Silas, they were going from town to town, going into those marketplaces, telling people about Jesus Christ. In one of these towns, they went in and they started preaching Jesus, but there was a slave girl there who had an evil spirit, but this evil spirit gave her the ability to tell fortunes. She could tell people what was going on in their lives and give them wisdom and direction, and her slave masters were making, it says, tons of money off her, because people would come for her, she would charge a rate, and so they were sitting back, the easy life, they were having her do all this fortune-telling stuff, and they're just reaping in the big bucks. Well, this servant girl, the slave girl, when Paul and Silas and company come into town, she starts going after them saying, "These men are of the Most High." So in other words, they are telling you the way to be saved. And you typically think that was a cool thing. You know, if I went into Halifax or if our team goes into Halifax and someone goes before them saying, "These people represent God. And they're not just going to give you sandwiches. They're going to show you how to have eternal life." You think, yeah, that's a cool thing. Well, after this was going on for several days, Paul was getting really frustrated because I guess she was interfering. And you know what? If you're going to have someone promote you, you probably don't want it to be an evil spirit. So Paul finally, in an act of frustration, turns to the girl and says to the spirit, you come out of her immediately. That spirit actually, because he had the authority of Christ in his life, he exercised a spiritual authority over that spirit, and that spirit had to leave instantly, and it did. And that's good news for the girl. That's bad news for the girl's owners, because their source of income suddenly just disappeared. They're not overly impressed by this. So when they realize that their source of income has disappeared, they go up and they grab Paul and Silas. The others, I guess, spread out. And they grab Paul and Silas, they drag them to the marketplace, to where the magistrates were, and they say, "These men are causing a riot in our city. They're teaching things that aren't lawful for us." And you know, Paul and Silas don't have a chance to say anything. They don't have a chance to defend. The crowd starts inciting against them, and the magistrates, just listening to the crowd and these accusers, then say, command to have Paul and Silas stripped and then beaten. It says flogged in the NIV, but the idea here is they are beaten with rods. And there's wounds all over their body now. Then they say, send them off to prison. And he specifically tells the guard, says, "You guard them carefully." So the guard takes them into the prison, into the inner cell of the prison, and it says they threw them into the cell, and the word there literally is threw them in. Basically, like when you take something and you just scatter it. You picture them opening up the doors to the inner cell and just throwing Paul and Silas in on the floor. I mean, they're beaten, they're weak, they're bleeding, they're sore. And then he takes them in, and he straps them down and puts their feet in stocks, and he leaves them there. You know, no trial, no opportunity for defense, just thrown into the prison, put in stocks, no treatment for their wounds. How are you feeling? How are you looking at life at this point in time? Have you ever had someone treat you unjustly? Have you ever had someone make accusations of you that weren't true, and you didn't really have any chance to defend yourself? You didn't have your chance to give your side of the story. It wasn't permitted. That permission wasn't given. You just had the accusations and then judgment and unjustified condemnation. Have you ever had that happen to you? And how did you feel at those points in time? Did anger start to well up in you? Did you start playing the justice game and you start pinpointing everything that was unjust about their actions? That if you got what you deserved, here's what you'd get, and here's what they should get, here's what they deserve as a result? Did you find that in your heart you started to judge the person? And I don't mean judging their actions, but did you start to judge their worth and their value as a person? Did you start to say, you are a failure, you are wrong, you are, and you start lowering the person down. You take them down a notch, you take them down another notch, you take them down another notch. You might not have been doing that verbally, but in your heart, were you doing that? Were you taking that person down a notch? I'm going to take you down, 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 down. And the more you let it brew in your mind, the more you take them down another notch. Did you find then as a result, you start to condemn them when how you treated them? Did you either become aggressive? Did you withdraw? Did you stop showing them love as an act of condemnation? How did it affect your walk with God? You know when it's affecting your walk with God, when your circumstances and when your relationship with others starts to affect your own personal peace and your own personal joy. We can think, oh no, it's all based in those people, but if your peace and joy are gone, God says, no, peace and joy are gifts of the Holy Spirit. They're not gifts from my coworker. They're not gifts from my family member. They're not gifts from my children. They're not gifts from my neighbor. That joy and peace are gifts that come from God. So in any circumstance I find myself in, no matter how terrible or how frustrating it is, there should still be a joy and a peace in my sense of identity, my worth, and who I am in relationship with God. And if my joy and peace disappears, then that's an indicator there's something going on with me and God here too. Well, it says in Acts 16:25, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. I'm thinking, wait a second, this is late at night. They've had this incredibly brutal day. They're now not just physically tired just from, gee, I've had a long day of preaching. They've been preaching. They've been dragged into the downtown market. They've been attacked by a mob, by a riot. They've been stripped. They've been beaten. They've got these wounds and sores all over the body. They've been thrown into a prison. And here they are, now sitting in the prison up until past midnight, praying to God. And when Jewish people prayed, they didn't pray quietly between them and God. It was out loud praying to God so that everyone could hear. Then there was singing praises to God. And the question is, how is this possible that in the midst of all they're going through, that they were able to experience this? God let them, in the midst of them telling other people about God, God let them be beaten. And you know what? Maybe, okay, a few strokes of the of the bar, of the rod, but it would have been a repeated beating. And God, why would God let that continue? Why didn't God stop? Why didn't he just have us arrested? Why did he have to let us go through this incredible beating and now be put in stocks? When you start questioning where God's at in his love for you and how he's protecting you, how God's caring for you, and how God's looking out, might that start be going through your mind? But it says that Paul and Silas were praising God at this very time. How are you relating when you get into frustrations? What's your perspective? Is it causing you to praise God? Or is it causing you to start questioning God? Do you start questioning his goodness? Do you start questioning his love? Do you start questioning his power, his sovereignty, his control? Do you start start judging God? Saying, you aren't good. You aren't fair. You aren't. Because otherwise, you would never let this happen to Well, Paul and Silas have grown in their relationship with God to such a degree that they understand who God is. And Paul even wrote this one passage. This was one of the first letters that Paul ever wrote in the New Testament. And it comes from 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 16 to 18. It says, be joyful always. 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 Really. When you go to work tomorrow, be joyful always. When you go home to your family and you have a tension you have to deal with, be joyful always. Pray continually. Keep saying, God, give me wisdom. God, give me wisdom. God, give me wisdom. God, give me grace. Give me grace. Give me peace. Give me patience so I can represent you well to this person wherever I am and whatever I'm doing and whatever they think of me, whatever they're doing to me, may you just help me to love them on your behalf because that's what a God of grace does. So it says, be joyful always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do you realize that every single time we are not thankful, we are disobedient to Jesus Christ? And we've totally lost perspective on who he is and what he wants to do through us to impact the lives of other people. We get focused on how things aren't meeting my needs and my expectations and how people aren't serving me or how people aren't loving me. Me. And God says, would you just get your eyes off me? Because I'll take care of the me. I'll take care of you. I'll meet your every need. And so what I find interesting is that Paul said this. He says, pray joyfully. Give thanks in every, or give, be joyful always. Pray continually and give thanks in all circumstances. And then after Paul states that, God then gives him an opportunity to show that he backs up his words with his actions. Paul just doesn't tell others to be joyful always and to pray continually and to give thanks without ceasing. He backs it up in how he lives. He has now been beaten. He's now been rejected. He's been thrown in prison. He's now there with wounds cut open, with being tended to. And what's he doing? He's being joyful always. He's praying continually. And the other prisoners and the guards are listening to him give thanks in all circumstances. Do you think that that might have to have a little bit of an impact on the people around him? The jailer and the other prisoners were sort of astounded as they listened to Paul and Silas praise God despite their circumstances. I think the other prisoners and the guards must have been captivated by their personal prayers in relationship to God. I think they had to be blown away by their faith and courage. But what really pushed the jailer over the edge was Paul's incredible display of grace and love for his enemy. You got to understand this, that this jailer is a hardened man. You could not be a jailer in this type of culture, in this type of environment, where
you are responsible to deal with criminals and traitors to the Roman Empire, and you're going to throw them into the prison. I mean, you disingenuous. Oh, here, Paul, let me help you sit down gently. Oh, can I get something for your wounds? Would you like a cup of coffee? You know, jailers weren't quite like this. These jailers were people that dealt with death and torture and punishment. They're hardened. This is the type of guy that's listening to Paul and Silas in prison. And then around midnight, suddenly, there's this great earthquake. The earthquake, it says it shook the entire foundation of the prison. Doors are suddenly swinging open, and even the chains that held all the prisoners broke free. And the prisoners were loosed. The jailer, it's around midnight, he's obviously napping. He wakes up when all this takes place. And when the dust settles, he realizes all the prison doors are open. And as he looks in some of the rooms, the chains are empty. He understands he was told to guard these prisoners carefully. And he knows that the consequence for his crime of letting prisoners escape is that he would be tortured and put to death. So instead of having the Roman Empire do that to him, he figures, I'm going to do it far more quickly. I want you to understand, though, this too. This guy has a wife. This guy has children. This guy has a household. But when he knows, when he sees what's happened and he knows what's going to happen to him, he says, better for everyone that I just end this quickly. He takes a sword out and he's about to fall on his sword when suddenly he hears this voice that yells out to him and says, stop! Don't kill yourself! We're all here. I don't get it. This was an incredible opportunity for Paul to be free. You got to think through what were all the other prisoners thinking, but what I don't get is that all the other prisoners, when this happened, they went to where Paul was. See, the guards, seeing that the doors are open, the chains are free, he assumes everyone's gone. But you know what? They all gathered in the inner cell. This is where Paul is. This is where Silas is. And from there, he yells to the guard, don't kill yourself. We're all here. Isn't this a chance for justice? Isn't this the one chance for freedom? Isn't this an incredible miracle where God comes to the rescue of his servants and his children that have been proclaiming him and have been treated unjustly, and God now causes this earthquake to loosen the chains and open up the doors. God's now got this incredible wide door open. Paul just has to walk through it, or he just has to wait for the guard to kill himself, and then he can walk through it. And you think, what an incredible testimony of God's power and display. Here we were in prison, and God rescued us miraculously. You see, this happened not just in chapter 16 with Paul and Silas. This happened way back in chapter 12 with Peter. Peter was in prison for doing the same thing, for telling people about Jesus Christ. And in the middle of the night, God sent an angel to Peter, and the angel wakes Peter up, gets him standing, and as he walks through, the doors unlock and swings open, and the angel just guides Peter through the doors. And Peter's thinking he's just having a dream, a vision, until he gets outside and the angel disappears, and Peter looks around and says, I'm free. And then Peter goes off to the house where everyone's been praying for him. You see, that's what God did there for Peter. Wouldn't it make sense to think that that's what God's doing for Saul or for Paul right now? He miraculously opens up all the doors. God gives Paul an open doorway to freedom. And if God gives you an open door, shouldn't you take it? Apparently not all the time. God opened up the doors. This time he didn't send the angel to escort Paul and Silas out. This time, Paul stays in the inner cell, or he stays with the prisoners wherever they've gathered. And he stops the guard from killing himself because Paul cared about his enemy. Paul cared about the guard.
And as soon as Paul does this and says these things, it says the jailer called for lights. He rushed in and fell trembling. This hardened man, this hardened soldier, this hardened jailer. Now, because of what he's listened to through the whole night about joyful praise and prayer to God in the midst of incredibly terrible circumstances, this hardened guard comes in trembling and falls before the feet of Paul and Silas and says, "What must I do to be saved like you?" Incredible, isn't it? It was not just the modeled life that impacted the guard. It wasn't just their prayers and their praises. It wasn't just modeled faith. What it was sacrificial grace that was shown to him that really broke through the hard exterior of his soul. Sometimes people just don't need to hear what you have to say. They don't just need to see praise and faith modeled. Sometimes what they need to see is that you're willing to give your life for theirs, that you value them that much, that you set their freedom above your freedom. Because this is what Paul was doing, wasn't it? Paul was trading his life for the guards. For all Paul knew, he could have been executed the next morning. That happened to some of the other proclaimers of Jesus Christ in those days. They're put in prison and executed. That could have happened to Paul too. For all Paul knew he was doing, he was trading his life for the jailers. Interestingly, he wasn't just trading his life, he was trading all the other prisoners. Why would the other prisoners, have been willing to let Paul yell out? It's because obviously the other prisoners were convicted too. There was something about the message and the faith and the God of Paul and Silas that they said, this is a game changer. This changes my every approach to life. So they replied in Acts 16:31 to the jailer's statement, "What do I have to do to be saved?" It says, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household." Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house too, whether that's wife, children, servants. And at that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds. Then immediately he and all his family were baptized. The jailer brought them into his house and set a meal before them, and he was now filled with joy because he had come to believe in God. He and his whole family had come to believe in God. And so it's kind of amazing that grace opened the door, not for Paul's freedom at this point in time, but grace opened the door for the message to be heard and embraced. And it brought eternal life to a family. Because the whole family now heard the gospel, the whole family responded, the whole family now said, "We are going to get baptized to proclaim our relationship with Jesus Christ." This is a pretty incredible story to me to think through. He was willing to trade a lot. He wasn't just willing to trade acceptance. He just wasn't willing to trade respect. He was willing to trade his life to see a total stranger, someone that treated him harshly, know Jesus Christ and be saved. Kind of cool. Well, when daylight came, the rest of the city isn't quite so sold on Jesus Christ yet. And so Paul is still a prisoner. And so it says that the magistrates then sent their officials to the jailer with the order, "Release those men now. Let them go." So the jailer told Paul, basically, "Paul, this is great news. The magistrates have ordered that you and Silas be released. Now you can leave. Go in peace." Paul says, no. There's go, what? He says, Paul now gives a message to the officials. Let's just do a quick recap here. They beat us publicly without a trial. They beat us publicly with not even a trial. And they didn't even ask to inquire whether or not we were Roman citizens. Suddenly, terror overwhelms the magistrates as the officials go back with this message. You see, they had authority to treat non-Romans however they wanted. But you didn't have the right to treat a Roman citizen however you wanted. In fact, if you treated a Roman citizen in such a way, that would be the death penalty for you. Do you understand that the magistrates are now a little concerned? They had Paul beaten, not without even a trial. There was absolutely no foundational basis for why they should have treated a citizen of Rome in such a way. And if the emperor had heard about this travesty, what would have been the fate for those magistrates? So, Paul says, they beat us publicly without a trial, even though we are Roman citizens, and threw us into prison. And now they want to get rid of us quietly. No. Let them come themselves and escort us out. So the officers reported this to the magistrates, and when they heard that Paul and Silas were Roman citizens, they were alarmed. They came to appease them and escorted them from the prison, requesting them to leave the city. And after Paul and Silas came out of the prison, they went to Lydia's house, where they met with the brothers of Christ and encouraged them. Then they left. You know, Paul does have a little bit of a sense of humor. He does play the let's get even a little bit type of game. He does tease, in a sense, the magistrates. But you know what? Even then, Paul doesn't give them what they deserve. Paul doesn't necessarily report their injustice. Paul doesn't make them pay the price. Again, Paul just shows grace, and he just leaves town quietly. You know, I want you to understand and really reflect that this is what Jesus Christ has done for you. God comes to you at a point where you've been resisting Him, resisting Him, resisting Him, resisting Him, resisting Him your entire life. You keep putting Him off. You keep coming up with reasons as to why you should not entrust your life to Jesus Christ, why you should not follow God. You keep coming up with reasons why you need to stay in control. You keep coming up with reasons why you have to reject God's rule in your life. But God still comes to you and says, I'm giving you another opportunity. Will you bow the knee? Will you accept the forgiveness that I offer you? Will you come and be part of my kingdom, part of my family? Or will you continue to resist me? And you know, in the grace of God, He's giving you permission to continue to resist Him for now without consequence. I can't say without consequence. There's going to be natural consequences for resisting God, but without His judgment. God is withholding judgment. Even though it says in Romans 5:6-8, it says, you see, at just the right time when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love for you in this. While you were still rebelling against Him, doing your own thing, living your own life, living a life of sin against Him, at that point that God sees you doing all that, He says, that's when He died for you. Christ died for you as the most incredible act of grace possible. He paid the price for you so that you could be restored back to God. And now it says that He is even holding off judging you to give you a longer time to turn to Him. Listen to what it says, 2 Peter 3:9. The Lord is not slow in keeping His promises, as some understand slowness. And that's with talking about Christ's return and His judgment of the earth. But the reason that Christ is holding that off is because He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. See, Jesus has a mission. He came to restore you back to what He created you to be. He came to restore you back to a relationship with the Father. He came to restore you to His kingdom. And many of you have said yes to that restoration. Many of you said, I bow the knee. I accept Jesus as Lord and leader of my life, and I surrender my life to Him. I want that restored relationship. But Jesus knows that there's many, even here in this room, and many outside this room, who have not yet responded to Him, and they will be under judgment. And he says, I don't want them to experience that. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to hold off judgment a little longer to give you opportunity to go out there and share with others the life that God wants to give them and the life that he wants to rescue them from. And as this atheist was saying in the video, saying, how much would we have to hate somebody to not share the good news of the forgiveness of Jesus Christ and eternal life with them? How much would we have to hate somebody to say, my need for comfort and acceptance and respect overrides your need for eternal life? How much would I have to hate somebody to not cross a street? How much would I have to hate somebody to not cross my office space to a coworker? How much would I have to hate somebody to let them just quietly walk off into judgment when God says he wants them to have forgiveness? And so as we wrap up this series on grace, I really want you to think through. If you truly believe you've been saved by the grace of God, then you need to understand it cannot stop with you. That the mission is for the people in your circles of influence to know God has placed you in various circles of influence where he wants you to shine brilliantly for him. He wants his love to be represented, but he also wants his truth to be spoken. And whatever circles of influence you find yourself in, what are you going to do with that influence that you now have? And will you stay quiet, or will you, out of the most incredible act of grace, sacrifice self so that others might know Jesus Christ? And if that's what God's speaking to you in any way on this theme as we wrap up this series on grace, you might want to write that down on your connection card. If you're saying, gee, I'm not sure I have that relationship with God, and you'd like to talk with us about that, I'm not here for the next 3 weeks, but Gordon is. He would love to get together with you. All you have to do is put down, I'd like to talk to a pastor. And you can just check that box, and Gordon will give you a call. And he'll talk to you about what it means to know God. And so we just want to encourage you, if you are a child of God here, you have been given a mission. And it's not Rob that's given you the mission. Jesus has given you the mission, and it's to complete his mission. So go do that. And then share stories of how that's going with your growth groups. And spread the excitement. Talk to George. Talk to Angie. And let's start reaching out beyond ourselves. Let's pray. Father, the hard part here is I now need to back up what I preach. I need to be able to do what I'm encouraging others to do. And Lord, that's hard. That's with fear and trepidation. I've got all the excuses as to why I shouldn't go talk to somebody. But Lord, I pray that myself, together with everyone else in this room, that you would call us to conviction, not out of guilt, but out of a passion to see other people know you. Would you place your passion for others in our hearts? Would your Holy Spirit do that even this morning? Would you give us a concern about the eternal destiny of others? Would you give us a concern that people know you in their life now and the joy and peace you want to bring in their life now? And Father, would you just motivate us to not just look for opportunities as they arise, but to create opportunities to share you with others. And may your church grow as a result. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.